I've had this tune rolling around in my inner being for 2 weeks now. Obviously, the song was written, "I'm No Longer a Slave to Fear." But when the Lord started prompting that song in me, you know how you get a tune on your heart and you just sing it? It came out, "I'm No Longer a Slave of Sin." And I started thinking about that in connection to the scriptures. Romans 6:14 says, "Sin shall not have dominion over you." Hallelujah. I want you to point to yourself, says, sin has no right in me, has no dominion. For you are not under the law, but under grace. That word dominion means mastery. I am no longer mastered by sin. That doesn't mean temptation doesn't come. That doesn't mean deception isn't tried by the enemy. All of those things are in play. But when you know who you are in Christ, I want everybody to say, I'm in Christ. And in Christ, I am a child of God. So I no longer have to fear sin in my life. Hallelujah. The Message Bible puts it like this. Sin can't tell you how to live. After all, you're not living under that old tyranny any longer. You're living in the freedom of God. The tyranny referred to here is the law of sin and death. We're not under the law of sin and death, but we have been given the grace of God to live above it. I would like a working definition of grace, which means this: God's ability at work in us, for us, and through us. Say that with me. God's grace is His ability at work in me, for me, through me. Hallelujah. God graces you for things. I think one of the first times that I really recognized grace in my life was after B and I sold our businesses and God called us and we went to Rhema. Now, it's interesting, and I only say this just to show you a contrast of grace. When B and I left Winter Haven after we'd expanded our stores and so forth, and now I have sold the stores, and so we're all loaded up. We left a 5-bedroom home on a beautiful lake. I had a bass boat that you could just lift up with an electric winch. I had a brand new Mercedes in the garage paid for, and B had a Jeep Wagoneer. How many of you remember those Jeep Wagoneers used to have the wood around them with leather and cloth interior? Those were beautiful. They're supposed to be bringing those back. I think when they do, I'm going to get her one. I'm just playing here. But no, they were fantastic. Anyhow, looking in the natural, we had it made, but there was something I couldn't explain to anyone working within me, and that was to prepare myself for ministry. I couldn't even put it in words to be. As a matter of fact, when we first talked about it, she just said to me, and I had been to one of Brother Hagin's meetings, and I'd heard him talk about Rhema, and I just somehow in my heart felt God wanted us to go out there and go to school. I had been to Bible school years before, to be honest with you. I blew that opportunity. I was a mess. How many of you here ever been a mess? Aren't you glad God delivers messes? Aren't you glad for that? Hallelujah. I thank God for that. And he did. And he did that for us. And I'm back on the road that I'm supposed to be on. But I had to have a redo. Because somewhere in life, I had taken a wrong turn. And somewhere in life, I had not followed exactly the plan of God for my life. So he rerouted me. I had to have a redo. Matter of fact, if you don't understand this, God has a test for you, and it's called a test of obedience. God doesn't beat you up with cancer and heart disease and liver disease and all the bad things and bankruptcy and divorce and all the mess that people like to blame on God. He doesn't kill your babies. He doesn't do that stuff. But he does have a test in you to see if you'll obey him. He will tell you to do something, and when he tells you to do something, it takes faith to act on it. Faith pleases him, and so when you obey God through faith, it works in an amazing way, and God always has a blessing attached to obedience. Say that, always, God has a blessing attached to obedience. Praise God. And so he did. And in our case, he kept dealing with me to go back to Bible school. And so I obeyed God and I went. I'd been listening to Brother Hagin's teachings for many years. As a matter of fact, the first time I ever met Brother Hagin, I said the dumbest thing you've ever heard. I was at a Christmas banquet, and he was sitting on a little platform they had raised a little bit so the students could come by and speak to the Hagin family. And Brother Hagin was there, and I said to Brother Hagin, first thing that I've ever said to Brother Hagin in my life, I've slept with you a many a night. That was as dumb gets. But Brother Hagin caught what I was telling him, and his little belly started jumping. Well, it wasn't little. It's like mine. It's a little bigger. But anyhow, started jumping up and down. And he thought that was the funniest thing. But that was the truth. I had gone to sleep night after night after night with a hunger for the word that I couldn't explain to anybody. God had visited me when I was in my late 20s. He had come to me and he dealt with me. And for just years now, I'd gone to sleep listening. I'd drive down the road in my car and I'd listen to teaching and the word of God. And something had reignited inside me that I had left behind in my earlier life. And I could not shake it. I didn't want to shake it. I would get up in the wee hours of the morning and I would walk back and forth in this room we'd built for our kids' toys, and I would pray and seek the Lord, and there would be times the presence of God would fall in my room in an incredible way. It was an incredible way. I would sense God's presence in the stillness of the room. The presence of God sometimes is so still. It's amazing, but it's so potent in force. Hallelujah. And I had these experiences in God, and I was drawn by the Spirit. I was drawn. And so finally I go to Rhema, and I came into contact with that grace I'm talking about. God graced us. We'd left this five-bedroom home. We're in this condo, B and I, with three boys that were very rambunctious. And it was a true, genuine adjustment, yet we didn't notice it. It was like it didn't matter to us. Nothing mattered. I remember the day we loaded the big moving van, and we put some of our stuff in storage, and we took some of our stuff with us. And I remember the day that we did it. Nothing mattered. We sat in the driveway. There was no attachment. Nothing mattered to us. Why? Because God's grace had come to work in us, and his ability had gone to work in us, and we were willing to sell, give, do anything we had to do what God wanted us to do. Now, in my case, it was enter the ministry. In your case, it may be interest in your own business. It might be moving to a different job. It might be expanding where you are. There's many ways God graces us, but grace is God's ability in you, for you, and through you. Say it with me. In me, for me, through me. Hallelujah. And so that day, I felt, as we started moving in the presence of God, sure, there's headwinds. Sure, anytime you move out for God, the enemy's going to fight you. He's going to do everything he can do to stop you from moving in the will of God. But I have news for you. I'm not under the dominion of sin. I'm not under the power of Satan. I am a child of God. And as a child of God, I have the Holy Spirit living inside me. I have Jesus the Christ living inside me, functioning functioning through me through the Holy Spirit, and he causes me to be triumphant on earth. And beyond that, he has angels stationed round about me to bear me up, lest I dash my foot against a stone. There is no weapon formed against us that can prosper. Every voice that rises up against us is already judged. Hallelujah. Because he said, this is the inheritance. This is the inheritance of the servants of the Lord. You have an inheritance in Christ. Hallelujah. You in Christ, you have an inheritance. Not one of us would mind a relative leaving us a fortune. But you gained a fortune when you met Jesus. When he came into your life, you received an inheritance, and it's incorruptible. It is the seed of the Word of God, and seed bears fruit. And you and I get to walk in the fruit of the Spirit of the life of Jesus flowing in us, and we do not and must not yield to the spirit of fear or sin. Say out loud, I believe that. Hallelujah. Praise God. I thank God for this grace. Grace wherein we stand. Praise God. I want you to know this too. Grace is given to every one of you, not just me. It's important you point to yourself and say, grace has been given to me. Grace for life, but it begins with grace for salvation. It works the same way. Listen to this from Ephesians chapter 2. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses. How many of you can remember that day? Made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Did you know as a Christian, we need to be looking down. Not down on people, down on the earth. In other words, we're seated together with him in heavenly places. Jesus said, I rose victorious over death, hell, and the grave. He took his seat at the right hand of God, and we are the feet of Jesus. We are the body of Jesus, and the devil's under our feet. Praise God. And you and I are up here. We're seated with Christ in heavenly places. Glory to God. And no weapon formed against you is going to prosper. It may be formed, but it can't prosper. Hallelujah. Because I am a child of God. Hallelujah. He raised us together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Jesus Christ. That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Now notice, connected to salvation, for by grace you have been saved through faith. All right. And that not of yourselves. That's right. It is the gift of God. Yes, any gracing you get for whatever God calls you to do is the gift of God. It begins with salvation. Once you answer to that, once you come in Christ, once you're seated with him in heavenly places and everything is under you, the devil and all the enemies are under your feet because you're seated together with him. You're the body of Christ. You're the head, not the tail. He puts you over, not under. He makes a way for you where there is no way. He has called you to himself and he backs you up and he stands with you and he blesses you. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? For by grace you've been saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Now notice, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we, I want you to point to yourself. Say this, for I am his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Hallelujah. When it comes to empowerment, grace is empowerment. In not allowing sin to have dominion over us, it works just like salvation. You had no right to it. You couldn't earn it. There was nothing you could do. You were on the outside. There was not one thing you could do about it except God came along and he graced you. He graced you and he said, now, I've given you this grace, but you have to receive it by faith. Anything the Lord says to you, it is his grace at work, but it's received by faith. There's two operations going on. Things we don't deserve that he graces us for, but he backs us up as we follow him in faith, because faith pleases him. Without faith, you can't please God. These people that want to fight the faith message, there's something wrong with their head. There really is. They couldn't get saved without it. You can't get saved without faith. Every Christian, some people, they want to fight faith. Why would you fight faith? You didn't get saved except through faith, by grace through faith. That's the only way you came to the kingdom. And once you come in the kingdom, he graces you to live a holy life. He wants you to live holy. Praise God. I want you to say out loud, God wants me to live a holy life, not an unholy life, a righteous life, not an unrighteous life, a pure life, not an impure life. Hallelujah. It's so important we get that as Christians, because this helps us. You know, you're going to think this is funny, but I came home last night. I'd been down to the church, and because I came in later, I stayed later. That's how I work it out. If the day goes longer on Saturday, I just stay later when I come to the church. And I came home, and I said, B, I'm so frustrated. I said, I've spent all this time. I've got 30 pages of notes. How do I take 30 pages of notes and put them in 30 minutes? It's not possible. So guess what? I sat down, rewrote my message to make it so that you wouldn't leave in the middle of it. I want you to enjoy church. I want you to enjoy the word. And I don't want to preach so long that you get bored and turn on your devices. I was at preaching at my home church one time years ago, North Carolina Assembly of God Church. And I got up and said, no, I don't preach long. And compared to some people, I don't. Some people, my Lord, they can preach forever. I remember Brother Norville. How many of you remember Brother Norville? I remember my friend one time, Brother Norville, went to his church in Georgia. The friend gave Brother Norville the pulpit at 11 o'clock. About, you know, close to 1,000 people there. And at 4:30, Brother Norville was still preaching. So my only question to my friend, Bob Wright, was, how many were still there at 4:30? He said about 50. And so, yeah, you do have to be mindful of people's time, you know, and also their seat. You can only sit so long, isn't that right? So I wanted to make sure I could put this compactly into a message. If I need to go on next week, I'll do that. If I finish today, great. But anyhow, I wanted you to get really solidly in your being, inside your being, that whatever God calls me to do, he will grace me to do, and his grace will make it sufficient for me to do. Hallelujah. You'll never be on your own. So we're out there. We're at school, but God was gracing us. It was an amazing time. Matter of fact, B would tell you, it was one of the best times of our entire life. And it was amazing how God graced us. Now, when it comes to sin, I want you to notice something Romans 8 goes on to say. Romans 8, and I'm going to read to you from the message. You say, why are you using the message? It's because it puts it in words that everybody can understand. Sometimes, like the King James Version, I love the King James. Most of the scriptures I've ever memorized are King James. Any scripture that comes to me, it'll come to me from the King James. Then I have to go look it up through another translation. But it always, when I pray the word, I pray the King James. But I do realize there's some blind spots in translation, meaning there's nothing wrong with it. You just don't always understand it. They use some antiquated terms. So I just like things that put it in everyday language, especially in a speaking environment like this. Notice Romans 8, and we're going to read verses 1 and 2. It says this, with the arrival of Jesus, the Messiah, that fateful dilemma is resolved, talking about sin. Those who enter into Christ, being here for us, no longer have to live under a continuous, low-lying black cloud. A new power is in operation. The spirit of life in Christ, like a strong wind, has magnificently cleared the air, freeing you from a fated lifetime of brutal tyranny at the hands of sin and death. Say out loud, praise God, I am free from sin. The spirit of the life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. The good news for everybody here today, if you know Jesus and are a child of God, You are graced to live sin free. You say, but I have to do it, but you don't. You don't have to do it. You don't have to enter something that grieves the heart of God. Because here's the thing, you know, there are certain things, obviously the Bible talks about that we shouldn't do. It names things that we shouldn't do, and then it says in such like. But the such like is where the Spirit of God becomes a part of your life. If you're heading in a direction that's impure, if you're heading in a direction that's not pleasing to the Lord, you know it on the inside. You come before God and there's something coming up between you. It's called sin. That's what confession is. That's what repentance is. There's people going around, they say you don't have to repent. There's actually people saying you don't even have to be born of the Spirit. It's universalism. Everybody goes to heaven no matter what. There's people who once knew the truth, who took a diversion, and they're teaching crazy stuff out there. Don't you go with that stuff. You just go with the Word of God. If you can't find it clear in the Word of God, don't you pay any attention to it. I'm telling you right now, I want the whole counsel of God. I don't want to cherry pick a few verses and make my doctrine out of it, say anything I want it to say. You know, you can take the Old Testament and you can make things up. You can make it say whatever you want it to say. But I love the fact that the New Covenant holds the Old Covenant in light. Praise God. It is the revelation of the old. It brings to us what God intended from the very beginning. And so live by the Word of God, by every word of God. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Jesus said this, whom the Son sets free, that's who's free indeed, the one He set free. Finally, like I said, I'm not going to preach long today. I just want to, maybe this is an introduction, maybe it's a conclusion. Who knows? It is a conclusion today. Finally, all that's left to do is to take something off and to put something on. That's all you got to do. Amen. Now notice Ephesians 4. But you have not so learned Christ, if indeed you have heard Him and have been taught by Him as the truth is in Jesus. Now notice, that you put off. Who's to put it off? I am. That you put off concerning your former conduct. See, He graces you to do that, but you have to do it. The old man, put them off, which grows corrupt. You see, that's the way sin works. It's degrading. It brings you down. Down, down. It starts to where you're not absolutely sure this is wrong. Well, maybe I can get by with that. Next thing you know, your conscience starts getting seared. And before long, degradation begins to set in. And you go further down, down, down. And the Word and the life of the Spirit's wanting to bring you up, up, up. Hallelujah. Just say that out loud. I'm not going down, down, down. I'm going up, up, up. When you start to do something that the enemy's tricked you with this week, you just say right out loud, no, no, no. I'm not going down, down, down. I'm going up. I'm going up. I'm going up. When that drug dealer tries to pull you aside and sell you something you shouldn't be smoking or you shouldn't be doing, you just say, no, no, no. I'm not going down, down, down. God, send your grace. Help me to go up. Up, up. For the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made you free from the law of sin and death. You don't have to do it. This thing said, I don't have a choice. I have to do it. That's a lie right out of hell. Actually, we've got a new term today that they're making very lively called fake news. That's fake news, my friend. When you're told you have to do it, that's fake news. You don't have to do anything. The devil is a liar. He's the prince of deception. You don't have to yield to him. And here's the thing. It's tantalizing in the beginning. It looks bright to your eyes. It looks enticing. But when you enter that door, you wish I could go back out that door. Because when you get in that door, the door closes behind you. And the next thing you know, you are entrapped. You're enslaved. And he says, you're no longer a slave to sin. Come out of it. Shut the door. Walk forward. And don't you let the enemy pull you back, drag you back, pull you down, and swallow you up. Why do you think that song is so stirred in my heart? Because God wanted you to hear what it would produce in me this week. That I want you to know you are not under the bondage of sin. No, you don't have to live a sin life. You can live a free life. Praise God. Sin binds. Freedom brings you blessing. Can you say amen? Say out loud, I believe that. He said, now put off your former conduct, the old man which grows corrupt according to deceitful lust, and be renewed. Now here's where the battle is, in the spirit of your mind. It's your mind that gets you in trouble. Renew your mind with the word of God. Hallelujah. And build yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in that heavenly prayer language. Praise God. Please do not forget that. Point to your head and say, the battle's in my mind. And then notice, don't stop there. Here's something else you need. Don't just take something off. That's what the Old Testament people tried to do. They tried to live it in their own strength. Don't just take something off. And that you put on the new man, which was created according to God. Now notice how it's created, in true righteousness and holiness. Righteousness is that right standing place with God. What is it? I've been declared righteous, but righteous is also a walk. There's two kinds of righteous. One is the impartation of Christ in your life, who sets you free and declares you righteous. And then there's righteous action. And that's what we do. Righteous action keeps us in good standing with God, because you can't go out and just continue to do what you always did. And then true holiness, separation. Means separation. I've separated myself from the world. The Bible says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. He's not talking about things that you enjoy in life, nature, and the good things of life. He's talking about the things of the world that entice and pull you back into a spirit of bondage. That's what he's referring to when he says that. Separation, dedication, and consecration unto God. What is a consecration? My flesh wants to do something, but my spirit says, no, I'm going to let God consecrate me. I'm not going in that direction. I'm not going to yield to that. I'm going to yield to a life of truth. Can you say amen? Amen. Being a child of God, I'm going to finish up here in a minute, but I want you to hear this. Simply means we have been translated out of Satan's kingdom. Did you know something spiritual happened when you said yes to Jesus? The Spirit of God came. Just like somebody dies in this life and they get transported to heaven who know Christ. He comes, he translates you out of Satan's kingdom. It's done spiritually. And he sets you over into the kingdom of Christ. Hallelujah, his son. And that's what you're no longer over here in this old kingdom. You're no longer in your old man. Your old man's still there. Your body still wants to do things it always did. But there's a new man on the inside of you. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a brand new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, everything's become brand new. That old life no longer is attached to you. It wants to rise up, but you keep putting it down through the power of the Spirit of Christ in you. Can you say amen? Say out loud, I no longer am a slave of sin. Notice Colossians. He has delivered us. How many of you want to know you're delivered? He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us, or translated us, into the kingdom of the Son of his love. Now, what did we get? In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Whatever you've ever done, look at me and listen to me. I know the enemy tries hard to come back and remind you of your past. He loves doing that. But whatever you've done, point to yourself and say that, whatever I've done, the moment I come to Christ, whether before Jesus is in my life to be saved, or after Jesus is in my life when I need forgiveness, whenever I come to him, he brings me freedom, and he never holds what I did against me the moment I bring it under the blood. Hallelujah. How many of you got some things you're glad are under the blood? Don't let the devil keep bringing those things up. You need to remind him, listen, Mr. Devil, that's under the blood. The blood of Christ. You have no right to bring that up to me. You have no right to make issue of that. If I were to talk to God about it, he doesn't even know what it was I did. He took that sin, he threw it in the sea of forgetfulness, and it will never, never, never be remembered against me again. So if God has forgiven you, forgive yourself. If God has forgiven you, forgive somebody else. Don't hold on to the past. Don't hold on to the old. Don't hold on to the grudges. Get alive in Christ. Walk in the love of God. And the next thing you know, you'll go up, up, up. Hallelujah. Come on and praise the Lord and give Him thanks. That's the word of the Lord that needed to be delivered to you today. Would you stand to your feet and give Him praise in His house?